Hi, I'm Dave Monty. We're here at Coast Airbrush, and we're in the custom Coast Airbrush paint shop. And today we're gonna talk about how to choose the right airbrush for your painting needs. Okay, the first thing that we're gonna talk about are the two main differences between airbrush families, and that's double action and single action. And then we're gonna touch base on internal mix and external mix airbrushes. Okay, let's take a look at one of the first airbrushes here, which is known as the Pache H. This is what they call a single action airbrush. This is where you push down for just air, and you adjust the fluid by turning this cone here. Now this is also an external mix airbrush. This external mix airbrush means that the paint goes up through the fluid nozzle and the air comes out of the air cap and collides externally. This type of an airbrush is really not that great if you're looking for really good atomization, and it's not gonna allow you to dry the color as it's applied to the surface. An airbrush like this is more or less like an adjustable spray paint can. It is often used by people in the body art industry for doing stenciling and just covering kind of basic color fill in and some basic fades. It will do fades, but it just doesn't atomize as fine as the double action internal mix airbrushes. Okay, a few companies actually make what they call single action internal mix, which gives you the atomization, the smooth color fades and the blends. Iwata makes one known as the Revolution, and it's a part number SAR. That's kind of the identifier that they use. This brush actually uses the back of the handle assembly here to adjust the fluid needle in and out of the nozzle to control the volume of material. But it also is just an up and down motion, which basically just turns the air on and off. Now this will give you better atomization, but it's still a single action. And we're gonna touch base about the double actions in a minute and show you some of the advantages that you have with a double action airbrush. Okay, finally on to the double action airbrush. What I have here is known as the Theron Chandler Vega 2000. This is a stereotypical double action airbrush. It is what they call a bottom feed, and we're gonna touch base on some of the different cup configurations that double actions have in a little bit here. But what I wanna explain to you guys that are beginners out there is this brush, being a double action, allows you to push down for just air and back for color. The farther back I pull this trigger, the more fluid's gonna come out. So as I push down for air, the air is on. As I pull back, the fluid becomes on. As I push the trigger forward, it actually will push the needle all the way up into the cone, turning the paint off. So that is just your basic internal mix double action airbrush. Okay, every airbrush has to have a place in which to put the paint. So let's talk about the three different areas in which we're gonna load the airbrushes. Okay, the first ones that I wanna show you are known as the Gravity Fed family of airbrushes. So what we have here is a model Badger 100SG, which basically has a very, very small cup on the top. Now this is obviously for just very, very small amounts of color. Someone that really might use this is a detailed modeler or say a fingernail artist. That's kind of where these airbrushes are fashioned for. So this one, very small reservoir, not a lot of color, no lid on the top, so you have to be very careful when actually maneuvering over three-dimensional objects. Okay, the next airbrush I want to kind of show you guys is also a double action, internal mix, gravity fed, but it has a slightly larger cup on it than the one we just talked about. So this one is the Micron CMB. An airbrush like this is an extremely detailed airbrush, and it's used for basically fine illustration, some automotive work, but as you can see, there is no lid on this type of size of a cup, and it makes it difficult if you want to maneuver over three-dimensional objects. So with this airbrush, it's very specialized and only used for certain types of spraying. Okay, last but not least, we have the Iwata HPCS, otherwise known as the Eclipse airbrush. This particular airbrush has obviously a larger cup on the top and also a lid. Now this lid is just pressed on, it doesn't screw on or thread on as some people might think. It just kind of pushes on there and is stayed on by kind of the friction. So what we have here is obviously that larger cup. Now I love the larger cups. Not only do they hold a large amount of material, but they also give me an easier way to kind of get inside of here with a rag with my finger to rinse from color to color. So I actually find that if you get used to using the gravity fed cups with the larger, you know, cup on the top, it's gonna be faster color changes than trying to twist the cleaning rag down into the smaller cups. So the other advantage, once again, having the lid on the top allows for you to maneuver over a three-dimensional object. And it also makes kind of nice if you're using a material such as like an automotive urethane and you wanna add a little bit more thinner in there, you can just kind of put the lid right back on, put your finger over the top of the breather hole, agitate it, and basically pre-mix the color before you start spraying it. So this is the very, very, very popular gun in all the gravity-fed double-action airbrushes, is to have this size of a cup, otherwise known as a quarter-ounce cup. Others may refer to it as the C-size cup. Okay, we've talked about only three models of the different Gravity Fit airbrushes. I just want to kind of mention that there are a lot of different brands, and there are even a lot of different types of Gravity Fit size cups. There are even brushes that allow you to remove the cup and put different size cups on the same individual brush. So it depends on the manufacturer and you know, their configurations that they're gonna offer you. But the basic general Gravity Fit double action airbrush kind of comes in three individual sizes most of the time. Okay, now we're gonna talk about the most commonly known airbrush in the whole world, and that's the double action internal mix bottom fed or bottle fed style airbrush. What we have here is a really large selection of just different manufacturers and different configurations of the bottle fed airbrush. What the bottle fed basically means is pretty descriptive, is that you can basically take the airbrush and use the bottle to plug it underneath there as its paint container. Now, a lot of people don't know this, but in order to get the bottle to stay inside there, you don't just push it up into there because it can fall out. It's gonna use a little bit of a twist. So if you actually twist the bottle up into the gun, just like that, it's gonna lock in place and it's gonna stay there. Now, the same principle to get the bottle out, you're gonna always wanna twist. If you're gonna sit here and try to pull it straight out, it's gonna usually result in you kind of pulling really, really, really hard and then all of a sudden flinging the bottle off, and that can usually mean for a very big mess. So once again, you're just gonna push the bottle up into the tube of the airbrush and twist it to get it to stay. And the brush that I'm kind of showing you guys right now is known as the Iwata Eclipse, or part number BCS. This is a very typical all-around type of an airbrush. It's in my opinion that this brush is really suited best for the thicker viscosity paints, and also for people that are doing, say, t-shirts or wall murals, or things where they're gonna obviously use a lot more volume of material than the Gravity Fit style airbrushes. So this is just a brief overview of just some of the different models that we have to choose from. There is one other one in particular that I'll kind of bring in the camera's view, and it's really unique, and that's the HP BE1. This is also made by Iwata. As you can see, it's just a slightly larger airbrush, and it does have an adjustment on the end that allows you to control the round pattern. Back in the day, a good friend of mine by the name of Rhino and myself were doing large-scale murals for clubs. So this gun became one of our favorite airbrushes to use because we can still do all the smaller techniques that we would do with a small airbrush, but on a larger scale. So this was really unique in the way that it allows us to do like large-scale wall murals and things of, you know, that require the dagger stroke and other, you know, fine lines, but on a slightly larger scale. So this is a really unique airbrush right here. Okay, now that we've talked a lot about the bottle fed airbrushes, let's kind of focus in on what the containers options are that you have with a bottle fed airbrush. So down here we've got a bunch of different little bottles, some of which are glass, some are plastic, some are high density plastic, and then ultimately we have the small little color cup. First off, although these come in different sizes and shapes and configurations, you want to really pay attention to what type of paints that you're using. If you attempt to try to use one of these clear plastic bottles, these are not a high density solvent proof plastic, and you can run into a lot of trouble with the solvents just literally eating the bottle. So these are only really good for the water-based types of paints. You want to steer clear of the urethanes and the enamels with this particular type of a bottle. All the other plastic ones that are high density, these will typically be totally fine with any of the solvents, enamels, urethanes, whatever you want to put through there. And then of course the glass. Now glass is still very, very, very commonly used. Except I'm not a big fan of the glass for the fact that if you drop that, what's it gonna do? It's gonna break. So you're gonna have a mess just everywhere. Also the weight of the glass. Some people like the weight because it adds in the stability of how you use your airbrush. It kind of has that counterbalance weight down there. But I just kind of would rather play it safe, and most of our customers kind of feel the same way, and they're gonna go with plastic. Now, when you are using these bottles, there's a few things that you wanna remember. Number one, if you're gonna leave the paint into the container, you're gonna wanna use what they call a ready cap. Now this ready cap just goes onto the top of the bottle and kind of helps the paint dry, or keeps it from drying inside the tube. So these are a really handy tool to kind of help prevent the drying of the paint inside of the tube. The one other thing about the bottle that is really important, and it'd be hard for the camera to see, but there's a breather hole. There's always gotta be a breather hole, because as you suck the paint out of this bottle, it has to be replacing it with air. Otherwise, it just can't create a suction out of the bottle. So these little breather holes are often plugged up with either a piece of regular masking tape, if you're gonna store them, or a lot of guys will use like a push pin, or I've seen toothpicks, and just about anything to kind of stick it in there to keep the air from going inside there. But most importantly, you gotta make sure that that breather hole is open when you're actually using the bottle or the container. So The last but not least, side cup. These are kind of really unique, and there's different brands. We kind of carry the Badger and Pache, little chrome side cups, and these, just like a bottle, are going to be very easy to kind of see how they work. You're going to push them up into there and twist them, and they kind of sit right next to the airbrush, just like so. We now offer one that has a plastic lid on the top, which is fully solvent-proof on the plastic lid, and then, of course, the metal being completely solvent-proof as well. But that allows for people to use a bottom-fed airbrush that don't quite want to invest in a Gravity or just have a cup for just small amounts of liquid. But it's always my recommendation, which we're going to talk about in a little bit, to choose the right airbrush for your type of work that you do. And what often makes that determination is what you're painting on, and that determines the paint, and then ultimately the airbrush. But we're going to get into that in a little bit.